So we're going to just talk briefly about guidance and protocol papers. I'm going to try to keep the message relatively discreet here. The, you know, here are some disclosures for me. I have grant funding. I do some work for some journals. So the objectives, is to consider some of the deficiencies in the current reporting of clinical trials, review some relevant resources, and discuss actions for the future. So I thought it would be fun to try a little audience response. We will see if this works. So you'll see some instructions here. Okay, so if you go to pollev.com/WillMoyer, or you can text this number once to join, and then you're going to select A or B. So this is just a test to see if people have been paying attention and you're able to do this. But the question here is, have you found the stairwell between the second and third floors in this hotel? So I'm sort of interested in that. It should start giving people's responses. This is a large sample size here. So it looks like yeah, so this is the idea. Yeah, there'll be a couple other questions here to get through. So a fair number of people haven't found it. It's probably a little late now, but if you remember where the bar was for the opening presentation, it was just to the right of that as you go. You know, basically the stairs here on this floor are over by the bathroom back that way. And if you try to go down those stairs after the hotel is closed for the evening, you end up in a dark conference room. It's a little sketchy. All right, so, and then now here, this is a free text response. This is the next question. So this is what are some common deficiencies in reports of clinical trials in the medical literature? And again, you know, somebody wrote statistics on here already. Again, usually there are statistics actually in reports of clinical trials in literature, but thinking to the last clinical trial maybe you read in a journal, what was really missing? Exclusions, reasons, generalizability. And yeah, it's part of the consort statement is talking about this. How many protocol violations? Graphs, missing graphs, detailed reasons. So, all right. All right, cool. Writing the results. Go on to the next one. There's no way out. Okay. So the goals for you in terms of this, I'm not going to read this. But, so we've talked a bit about consort. There is a related statement that's related to protocol, something called the spirit statement. I put that into the box folder. So I'd like people to try to read the spirit statement in elaboration. I would like people to try to publish a protocol paper, particularly if they're going to be launching this protocol. And you know, I would like people to submit an abstract to the Society for Clinical Trials. Maybe a little bit too much of a call to action, but as a board member of the Society for Clinical Trials, I get paid nothing, but it would be good to see some, and there'll be a little bit of additional content on this that I'm going to get. So the question here is, I have found the box folder with the course materials, and we're not referring here to your small group folder. And you know, question A is yes, but choice B is no. C is, what is box? Did you mean Dropbox? thanks for putting that again. All right, so you know, again, most people have found the box folder with the course materials. I'm going to just, again, there's a link to this. This doesn't currently require a password before, you know, we put a password on it just because, you know, there's nothing really sensitive there, but there's some copyrighted materials. If you've logged into Box before and you go into this, it will then be part of your Box going forward. Again, you know, don't share this link. This is in your syllabus along with the password. It'll revert to having a password again probably next week. But again, if you look at your syllabus, this is there. So again, we put the slides for this course in there. We put specific handouts in there. So this is a place to go to kind of review some of the stuff that we've talked about during the course. So, as I promised, again, and in the interest of time and in trying to finish up some of these sessions, you have a spirit statement that came out in 2013, it's published in BMJ, and here's the reference. There is a lot of overlap with Consort, but there's a lot of elaboration that tells you things that you would be spelling out in your protocol that you might not be spelling out in the final report of your research. And one of the things that sometimes comes up is, if you're looking through this as a checklist of, did I cover this scientific area, consider really strongly whether your item is actually not applicable. The criticism is sometimes people say, allocation concealment is not applicable. But if you're doing a randomized trial, that's not how you generated the randomization ratio. That's whether your study coordinator, as they're approaching somebody, actually knows which group they're going to be assigned into, potentially, for an open label trial at the time that they're making that decision. So something to consider. It's most relevant for two-arm randomized controlled trials, but it has a lot of applicability for any sort of prospective clinical research, particularly involving interventions, whether those are drugs, devices, or behavioral interventions. And the consort extensions, perhaps for non-pharmacologic interventions, provide additional guidance for some of those specific methodologic areas. But I encourage you to take a look at that spirit statement and its elaboration as you're writing your protocols. Similar to some of my advice to, whenever I write a specific aims page, I go back and watch Dr. Silverglade's webinar and writing a good specific aims page. As you're putting your protocol together, taking a quick look at this before you're doing some protocol writing, can give you some good ideas of like, oh, I didn't consider that. And it has a nice template for a schedule of events as well. This is a little bit of that template. So let me just give a little bit of a plug for why you should publish a protocol. This is for transparency. If we're doing science, it's good to show the world what we're doing and put that down in advance so that we're not changing what we're doing afterwards. Reproducibility. Somebody else may be wanting to do a protocol in a similar area, and if we can match methods, Dan last night talked a lot about being collaborative. Science is better when it's a team sport, and the diseases that we are facing are hard and bad, and the more we can work together as opposed to being competitors, I think is very important. Replication, this is more of a thing in preclinical research. If a clinical trial is positive, we don't typically exactly replicate it because that would not be ethical, as we talked about. If new information comes to light, our control group may have to change. Promotes science and promotes collaboration, like we were saying. So publishing a protocol paper, there's an editorial in the journal Trials, one of the BMC journals in 2017, which this isn't an upload of the protocol, but it covers the main points, and a spirit checklist is a required element for this journal. They had published over 2,100 protocols, and if your protocol is funded, undergone external peer review, they use a relatively expedited process to get it into print. There are other journals that are very open to protocol type papers, International Journal of Stroke, BMJ Open. And this, as some of you have been putting together your protocols, you can see how helpful it would be to perhaps see a protocol in a similar disease and how people have addressed things. So all of this work that you're doing can help future investigators, and in addition to be a record of the transparency and openness of your protocol and that you're doing good science. In our development of our clinical trials, this is the trial that I'm one of the multiple PIs on, along with, in this room, Dr. Silverglade and Dr. Yates, the ICECAP trial for cooling after cardiac arrest. And we have developed our protocol. It's been approved by the FDA, so we have an open IDE. And we publish it online. People can go look at our protocol. People are worried, could somebody just take that, write a grant, submit it to NIH, and maybe get to do this trial? The short answer to that is, at this level, this is a multi-center trial of U.S. sites. Somebody could try that, but it would be very unlikely to work. And we think, since we have collaborators across many institutions who can contribute in unique ways, we put this out there so that people can see it and so that we can do science openly and in that sort of team fashion. Again, if you're doing an earlier phase trial, it may not be ready for that level of openness, but at someday when we're doing these larger trials, the more that we can be open with the scientific community, I think generally that is better. Now, if you're developing a novel compound and it's proprietary, there's plenty of reasons why, you know, openness at that phase isn't appropriate for that sort of design. But at least for this, a publicly funded trial, we're asking for taxpayer dollars to do this. We think, you know, using that methodology is has been good, and we, you know, it's been fun to have that out there. So the plug for the Society for Clinical Trials, again, this is not a disease-specific organization, but since you're here and you took this course, you all seem like you're interested in clinical trials. So it has an annual meeting in May this year. It's the 40th annual meeting, and it's in New Orleans, which is a nice place. It's a unique ecosystem where biostatisticians, clinicians, data managers, project managers, research coordinators, industry, government, students are all getting together and talking about the science of clinical trials. And again, the focus of this meeting isn't the results of clinical trials, it's the methodology of clinical trials. And this is the clinical trials methodology course. So, you know, I'd say consider submitting an abstract to this meeting. You know, there are sessions on recruitment, retention, design, operations, policy, ethics. We're about to start clinical trial on text messaging. We got a lot of great feedback on the toxicity of text messaging. We're going to text message people to send blood pressures, and people are like, you know, in our study we found that if you texted people every day, people found those texts to be toxic. And again, you know, we don't know what the dose toxicity of text messaging is. We all get a sense when we get those random text messages from people we don't know, like, somebody is interested in you or whatever, and like those things. Those are highly toxic. But for us, people are going into our study and they are, you know, they know that they're signing up for text messaging as a condition of their participation. So they're consenting to it at the beginning. But we give them ways to slow those down. But you meet a lot of really interesting people, and it's just a great ecosystem where you can, you know, it's in some ways similar to this, where you just get people together who are interested in doing good science in terms of the clinical experimentation place. All right, so this is, I think, the final thing here. So as we heard in one of the last talks from Mary Ann, open text fields are dangerous. Realizing this is a professional meeting, please say the first appropriate thing that pops into your head using that link there. Cats versus dogs, that's a really good question. That will come up, I think, on my final slide. Absolutely. This is like, post the fifth picture on your camera, Cool talk. I'm trying to make it a quick talk. No comment, yeah. Go Cats, yeah, no question. All right, so conclusions, be spirited, consider using the spirit guidance as you put together your protocol. I think you can be inspired as you read it. Try to be transparent, please publish a protocol. I think that will be good for you and good for science, and you can see how it can be useful. I do not have a dog, but the University of Michigan does have a therapy dog, and my son is pretty terrified of dogs. This is one dog that he gets along with, Bindi. So again, thank you for your attention. I'll be happy to take any questions while we get Dr. Deans' slides up. Yes. Yeah, no, that's a really good question. So to me, once I have the resources to do the trial, this is in the trial that I'm doing currently, I really want to, we have a couple little contract issues in terms of our text messaging vendor. This is like probably too much information, but until I'm starting to enroll, because I want to have my database set, I really want patients going, at that point where I'm enrolling patients, I think that's really the point where, you know, you're starting to get people into your study, you haven't had to make major changes. You know, IRB or funders haven't said, oh, change your protocol like this. So I think that's a really good point. Once you have the study up and running, hopefully you're not gonna have to do a lot of protocol amendments. But again, if you have to. But I think that point when you're starting to enroll, so you've got the resources to do the trial, but definitely prior to the end of enrollment. It sort of depends on how long of a duration you're gonna have. If you're only gonna be enrolling for a month, you know, it may be hard to thread that needle. But most of the time, it's rare that we have clinical trials where we only enroll people for a month. Not impossible, but it is. That's a really good question.
Hey, Will, how do you feel about sharing trial data in the spirit of open science and reproducibility? I don't think you have to.
So I feel good about it. The next talk by Sharon, that's its primary topic. And for some reason, like, and then, you know, maybe Joy, if you want to fix the computer while I address that. Like, for some reason, it came off the screen.
So I think that sharing of trial data is essential. I think people should be able to reproduce the statistical analyses. There are issues, though, because we need to protect the privacy of participants. So doing things in such a way that we honor the privacy of participants, but we allow others to be able to replicate our statistical analyses and our main results. I am an immense fan of sharing, you know, I don't think we should just do it just because the NIH says we have to. And for smaller scale studies under the 500,000 limit, you do have to have a data sharing plan, but it is not as required as it is for the larger scale trials. So I think it's a really good practice. You just have to have a plan in advance, which Sharon will tell you how to do. So that because the cleaning can be hard. You know, if you have potential information that is kind of identifying of the participants and so forth in text fields and stuff, maybe those aren't fields to share. Again, how that database gets cleaned in a way that it can be shared, I think is very important. University of Michigan has a data repository, something called Deep Blue, for exempt survey research and things like that. I have published my data sets into that space as I've made those publications, so people can look and potentially replicate my results, you know, in ways that are ethical and compliant with the research regulations. Some journals are now requiring this. The PLOS journals, Public Library of Science, really want to have the process by which people have access to data. On a just sort of tangential, you know, sort of note, when people do large database studies, again, this is not what we are necessarily doing here in our course. When people are doing large database studies, I'd like to see the analytical code if I'm reviewing it as a reviewer. That way, if somebody else was to do that database, that large database study, if it's something that's available or could be available with the right public, you know, with the right data use agreement, that people are sort of able to get at the same things or find errors in your code if you actually did something wrong.